I'm going to talk about data privacy a little bit. And every time I talk to people back at home about this topic, they say, why do I care? Nobody wants to track me. I'm not doing anything interesting anyway. It's great to be in Davos where all the people who don't want to be tracked are in one place and who actually care about this topic. So I feel like I'm in kindred spirits here. All right, I'm not going to have time to go through all of this, but I've been working with big data for the last 20 years across the founding of 20 different companies. Collectively, the companies that I've co-founded and been chairman of have given over $500 million to Google and Facebook, and huge amount of data involved. In the time that we've been doing this, the cost of storing a petabyte of data has gone from $150 million down there on the bottom to $75,000 a petabyte. A massive drop in the cost. It's predicted to keep going down from there. I'll talk about that in a second. And you can see in this history timeline here, a lot of changes, but I want to talk to you a little bit about what's going on your iPhone right now, or your Android phone. Every photo that you have on those phones is being recognized by AI and classified and turned into a name so that you can search for people by name on your phone. It's very convenient, but it involves a process on your phone looking at every single picture and identifying who's there, which means the data on who you're hanging out with is now being gathered and collected by Apple and Google. It's an interesting technology. I used to, early in my career, spend a lot of time working with neural networks, and one of the most fun things you can do in life is run a neural network backwards. When you run a neural network backwards, it actually generates things that never existed before. So I want to show you a couple of things that never existed before. Here you're looking at a neural network that's classifying Amy. Amy is the person on the left, and you can see it's turning her into her name, Amy. When you run it backwards, it creates an Amy that was never there. So you can make pictures like this, where Arnold Schwarzenegger and President Medvedev are looking at, that's Rob Fisher, the CEO of our incubator in that picture. Or it could be Jamie Dimon in that picture just as easily. Could be me skiing with my buddy Juno in that picture just as easily. Or maybe Jamie's in India right now, he's not actually in Davos. Or maybe my daughter and I are in India right now. Or maybe my wife Maura is on a 500 euro note. One of the guys from the office saw me making these pictures, which take all of 30 seconds each, and he said, I really need to be in one of these. I said, okay, you can only be in these pictures if you agree to be the most beautiful Cosmo girl. Or maybe Sandy Pentland is where he actually deserves to be, on Lionel Messi's jersey. This is all fun for me, but it's not so much fun for the FBI. The FBI thinks that deepfakes are a threat to national security. In fact, the images that I'm showing you a second ago are going to be indistinguishable from reality right about now in the next 5 years. So it's going to be an interesting decade trying to separate what's reality from what's not reality. This is all driven by incredible computing power and incredibly cheap storage. Moore's Law has been going on now for 30 years. There's a lot of debate on whether it's going to keep going on. We all know that things are going to get faster and cheaper. Nobody's quite sure at what rate anymore. People have predicted the death of Moore's Law for about 20 years now, and the debate is ongoing. But you can see this quote on the top left here from 1899, everything that can be invented has been invented. So the prediction of the slowdown of Moore's Law is very questionable. But some very big names predicting that things will slow down a little bit. We could use a little breather. I want to show you Google's machine learning word accuracy. Big, big change in the world in the last year or two. We now recognize speech as well as a person. The dotted line on the top shows how well a person recognizes somebody speaking. The green curve is how well an algorithm recognizes somebody speaking. As a person who worked on problems like this personally 20 years ago, I can tell you that it was a daunting task, and a lot of people thought that this would never happen. That it'd be just impossible to get a machine to do this. Now machines can recognize everything being said, turn it into indexed data, store it, and analyze it. Proliferation of data is exploding. We're up to, this is $500 million on this chart. There's about 1 billion Wi-Fi networks in the world now. That's not going to slow down. And then if you look at what Google alone can gather in terms of data, this is Google's market share in search. The blue is Google, the orange is also Google. Google's market share in mobile operating systems, that's the Android operating system. Google's market share in email, all of the emails are read by AI algorithms now, so everything that's in them is classified and indexed. And you can see Gmail is generationally growing, so younger people are using Gmail, huge penetration there. And in terms of knowing where everybody in the world is at any given time using your phone, Google has huge share there with Google Maps, and Google also owns Waze. This is a new one. Chrome has taken over desktop browsers. Chrome has absolutely dominated. That was not a big factor in big data collection because everything that happens on your browser tends to stay within your browser. That changed recently with sync. So now if you use Google Chrome, it'll ask you to sync. What sync does is it grabs your transaction or your browsing history so it can synchronize it across all of your different devices. But that means for the first time, all of your browsing history is being transmitted back to Google headquarters. So pretty much a complete profile of a person. So I want to end by telling you a little story. A friend of mine, Patrick Boyaji, who's the CEO of OwnUp, which is one of our portfolio companies, was talking to him about the future of advertising on Facebook. And OwnUp is one of our companies that's given collectively about $500 million, half a billion dollars to Google and Facebook over the last few years in ad spend. So we know a lot about this topic because we spend a lot of money on Google and Facebook. And he was saying that one of the ways that people tend to go wrong advertising on Facebook is they try to outthink it. And in reality, Facebook knows more about the consumer than you will ever possibly know. And so what you need to do is trust the AI algorithms, work with their AI algorithms, let them figure out what people want. And that made me think about this law that was passed back in the 1920s and early 1930s when radio and television first became really, really big. And we felt like at the time this law needed to be part of our democracy in order to have fair elections. So it was absolutely critical that any candidate get equal time and equal pricing in any election. So now that concept, internet advertising, is now bigger. It passed TV about 2 years ago, and now it's bigger than all other forms of media combined. So it's really the dominant media in the world today. And this kind of law now needs to be applied to the new media. But how on earth are we going to be able to write laws that offer equal time and equal access at equal rates when there's 3 to 10x leverage in the actual AI algorithms that are choosing exactly which ad to put in front of which person, but also which placement type? Everybody has different placement types they're responsive to. So the idea that we have to create laws that create a fair and equal democracy in that complex of an AI-driven environment is absolutely going to be a daunting challenge. But this is the crowd that's going to figure it out. The combination of the best computer scientists in the world with all the politicians in the world here in Davos at this crossroads. So if we're going to figure it out, it has to be here. Thank you very much.